Let's take a look at an example or two where we find the slope of a tangent line using the slopes of secant lines. And we'll organize our data in a table just to make it really clean and nice so that we can look for what the trend is, what the pattern is, what we call actually in calculus the limit. So we're going to look at the actual limit of these slopes of these secant lines. And I discussed just a brief introduction to this notation in the last video, where we take, when we're looking for the slope of a tangent line, since a tangent line touches a curve at just a single point, which is not enough to find a slope, so what we do is we look at secant lines through that same point and a second point on the curve, taking a look at those as we let that second point marching closer and closer and closer to the first point that is where we want the tangent. And that idea, that whole process, is this idea of a limit of those slopes of those secant lines as x approaches a. And this is just the slope formula right here coming out of y2 minus y1 over x2 minus x1, just the basic slope formula for the slope of a line passing through two points. Okay, so that's just a quick overview. If you want to, you know, freeze the screen, take some notes, but let's take a look at a specific example. So I grabbed the graph of this guy as well. You can see that on the far side of your screen right now, but we'll go over there in just a second. I grabbed the graph just out of Desmos so that we could have a visual to go along with what we're talking about here. But let's go through the problem first. So if we're given a function, f of x equals 7 over 4 minus x, and we want to find the slope of the tangent line, and actually ultimately the equation of the tangent line to that curve at a specific point at 5, negative 7. So if we take a look, this is obviously this particular function, this rational function, has a vertical asymptote when that denominator is equal to 0, which is at 4. And so we're seeing that curve right here. And this was just the curve in Desmos. And I'll scroll in a little bit so that we can see it. And there's that point right there that we want to look at. That point, I've graphed the tangent line, actually. Let's take that point. Get it, if I can get it right on there. Well, we're close. The curve that I'm moving here is, there we go. Finally got it. It's a little touchy here. So that's the point, 5, negative 7. So that's our point P. So we can actually think of that as point P. And we want the slope of that tangent line right there. And how are we going to find it? Well, the way we're actually going to find the slope of that tangent line, because remember, it's not enough to have a single point if you want the slope. You have to have two points. So what we're going to do is we're going to create a table of values, some x values around 5, and we're going to compute the actual slopes of the secant lines, and then we're going to let that second point that we've picked get closer and closer and closer to an x value of 5. So we'll do that. I'll organize it in a table here, but that's ultimately what we want to do, and we're going to take a look at what happens when we do that. So if I can, I'll come in here. And let's see here. So we're going to take, so the tangent line, that's the tangent line right there. But we are actually going to pick another point, and we're going to look at and I actually have this coded to do that. We are actually going to look at a second point. So let's just come out here. I mean, we could go out as far as we want. The closer we are, the better. So I'm going to make actually this value kind of close there, and there you can see. So you can see now we're going to look at a secant line, but we're going to bring that point in closer and closer and closer in our table. So we could come way out here, but then we're going to bring it closer and closer and closer in our table so that we are getting an accurate value, taking a secant line and letting the second point approach the first point so we have the actual slope of the tangent line. Okay, so to do that, I'm going to go ahead and create, I'm going to come over here, we can go back to the visual, but I'm going to take it off the screen here for a minute, and we're going to do this. We're going to create a table. You can create your table any way you want. I'll give you an example of how I like to create my tables, just to organize the data. I do like tables for organizing the data. So remember, we've got a point P, passes through the curve at the point 5, negative 7. We have a point on the curve, is what I should have said. We have a point on the curve, point P, 5, negative 7, and we want the tangent line there, and the actual function, I'm just going to recopy it over here so I don't have to keep going back and forth, was 7 over 4 minus x. Okay, so that's the point that we're starting at. We can think of this as our a, f of a, And we're going to pick some other values for x. We can think of those as b and f of b. So we're going to pick some other values. We were going to pick a second value, q, and we can think of it as a point b, f of b on the curve. And then, of course, the slope of the secant, just as a reminder, that's just slope formula, f of b minus f of a over b minus a. And so these x values that we're picking right here in this column, these are going to be our b values, but they're variable. So I'm titling them x because they're variable. They're going to change, right? We're going to let that b get closer and closer to 5. Now I'm actually going to organize my table and I'm going to show you guys looking at it from both directions. So if we think on our x-axis, I'm not going to draw the whole curve, I already have it graphed, but if we think on our x-axis at this point, here's the x-axis, if this is 5, there are actually two directions that we could pick points to the left or the right of 5. So we could be over here, we could pick something like 6, and then to make that even closer, we could go 5.5, and then we could go, should have made this maybe a little bigger, 5.1. We could go to the left of 5, we could say 4, and then we can make that closer and go 4.5, and even closer, 4.1. And just to have like a really clear picture of what this tangent line is, we are going to want to look at it at both sides to make sure that there's not something funky going on one side that doesn't occur on the other, or something different that goes on one side than what goes on the other side of a point 5. So we're going to make a table that's going to include values of secant, values of x values for secant lines on both sides of 5. So we're going to do that in our table. And we'll go one direction first and then we'll go back the other direction. So I'm going to go ahead and start filling it in. So let's think about, I want to get pretty close. So I'm going to actually just start at a little bit to the left of 5. I'm going to go 4.5 and then I'm going to go 4.1 and then I'm going to go 4.01. I'm going the wrong direction there. 4.5, 4.1. It's getting close to 4 instead of 5. 4.9, there we go, 4.99, 4.999. I think that's going to get us close enough. At the bottom of the table, I'm going to come from the other direction of 5, so maybe I'll start at 5.5, and maybe 5.1, and then maybe 5.01. Oh, shoot, let's go one more. I can always speed it up while I do the calculations. 5.005. So let's go many values, just so we can really see what's going to happen here and see those secant lines marching in. Then for me, it helps to also think about, okay, so what is the interval on the x-axis that I'm looking at here? So what is the interval from A to B that we're looking at? And I'm going to go ahead, and this is maybe a little bit slightly big column here. I didn't need it quite that big, but that's all right. So let's go, the interval here would be, we're looking from 4.5 to 5, and then 4.9 to 5, and then 4.99 to 5, and 4.999 to 5. And on this side, it's actually from 5 to 5.5. There's a little bit of a division here, if you will. Let's maybe just do a little squiggle. That's where we switched over a little bit. So I'll do a little bit of a squiggle there just to keep in mind that that's where we switched and then started coming from the right side of 5. And then we've got 5 and 5.1 and 5 and 5.01 and 5 and 5.001. So we're getting pretty close. I mean, you would have to be really zoomed in on a graph to look at a secant line between the two points x equals 5 and x equals 5.001. You'd have to be zoomed in very close. You'd have to really magnify the actual graph to see that. The other thing that I'm going to actually add in here as a column, and I think it's just an interesting thing to note, and we're going to utilize it when we get into the next couple of sections. And that is actually what we call the length of, it's actually delta x, the change in x. We're going to call it the length of the interval. If that's new notation, that little triangle right there, that's delta, and it means a change in value. So the change in the value of x on that interval. And I just want to record this here. We're not necessarily going to use this column, but I think it's useful to look at, because what we're doing is we're saying, okay, we're looking at a secant line whose delta x, whose change in x is 0.5. It's the difference here. It's b minus a. It's just the length of this. It's the actual length of this interval, just the difference between those two numbers, the distance between those two numbers on the x-axis. And so I'm going to just really quickly record this so that we can have a visual here of that actual length getting really teeny tiny. You know, 0.001 is a very small length. Okay, so I just want to record that. We're going to actually have the same lengths down here just because of the symmetry and the way I chose these numbers. And you can see that right here. Okay, so that's just kind of an interesting column. I'll write that down below. It's going to become more important to us in a couple of chapters, or a couple of sections. But this is our introduction to limits. And so we might as well start thinking about things like this. So this is going to become interesting. This is just an interesting value to consider. I'll just write it that way. I think that kind of sums it up. It's just an interesting value to consider. We're getting really small on that x-axis. That value is getting really small. The length of our interval is getting really small. Okay, so now I am going to compute these slopes of these secants, and I actually kind of strategized my table here, and so this is what we're looking at. So this last column is actually going to be the slopes of those secant lines. So for this one right here, I'm going to compute the slope. So the slope of the secant line right here is going to be f of 5 minus f of 4.5 over, I'm going to zoom in a little, over 5 minus 4.5. And so pulling out my calculator and doing that calculation, I get negative 7 minus a negative 14. I am plugging into the function to get these values. And then, of course, 5 minus, I'll write that one more time, but that is, of course, 0.5. And I end up with this value becomes 14. So that is the slope of the secant line through the two points, 4.5, and let's see, what was the output value there? Negative 14 and 5, negative 7. So I calculated that. I'm going to go ahead and mute the video. I'll speed this up so that you guys can see me filling in this table, but you don't have to listen to me do all the calculations. So I'm going to mute the video for now and then speed it up, and so you can see what happens with these slopes. Okay, so let's look at this filled in table now. Now that we've filled in all the table, done all the calculations, and I just used my calculator here and approximated the value so we could take a look. So remember, I have this dividing line right here because we were actually coming at this curve, picking our second point for that secant line. We were picking in the top part of this table, we were picking it to the left of 5, and in the bottom part of the table, we were picking our values to the right of 5. So we're coming from actually both the left and the right when we're looking at these secant lines. And I just want you to take a look at the pattern. As we come down and we look, as we get closer and closer and closer, right, as Q gets closer to P. And another way to say that is as X approaches 5, right, as our X value over here gets closer and closer to 5, as this is going closer to 5, take a look at what happens. What does it appear is happening to the slopes of the secant lines? And I would argue from this table, at first it goes, you know, it's 14 and then 7.78 and 7.07 and 7.007. But in those last two, it is looking an awful lot like it is approaching 7. And we could keep going. We could keep getting closer and closer. But I feel like I have enough in this table to say that it looks like the slope of the secant line is approaching 7. And let's take a look right here. Coming the other direction, right? Same thing, as P approaches, or as Q gets closer to P, again, as our X's are approaching 5, I would say that the secant line appears to be, again, approaching 7. And if that's what's happening, if the secant lines, as we let those values of X get closer and closer to the X value of the place where we want the tangent line, if that's what's occurring, then we can say it looks as if we could make this conclusion. So we could actually conclude that the slope of the tangent line is equal to 7. We could actually make a conclusion because we've created a table that shows that from both directions, right, from the left and the right, that we are actually approaching 7. Okay? So our secant lines, when we look at those slopes, are approaching 7. And so notation-wise, and again, this is jumping a little bit ahead into the next section, but notation-wise, what we can do is we can say this. We can say the limit of the slopes of the secant lines as x approaches 5 will give us the slope of the tangent line, and it appears as though that is 7 from our table. We can conclude from our table that that is, in fact, 7. Okay? Okay, so that is the slope of the tangent line. Let's zoom out here. There's our table. There's our graph. Try to get it all on one screen here. There's our graph. And as you can see here on the graph, if I actually were to drag that, that's a secant line. But if I were to drag that in closer and closer, that's the x values getting closer and closer and closer until we have that tangent line. And let's see if I can zoom in even a little bit further here. And that tangent line, that red line right there, has a slope of 7. Okay, so that has a slope of 7. Now, the original question didn't ask actually for just the slope. Okay, it said find the slope and the equation of the tangent line. So we have to go one step further. Okay, from the table, we've now made the conclusion that the slope of the tangent line is actually equal to 7. And so now we need the equation of the line. And this is just algebra at this point. And so we'll just do a little bit of algebra. We know that we've got a slope of 7, and we know that we have a point of 5, negative 7. However you want to do this, I don't care how you do your algebra as long as it's accurate. So if you want to use mx plus b, that's the way I'm going to go here. Y equals, we know the slope is 7x plus b. Now I just need to find the y-intercept. So I'm going to take that point, I'm going to drop it in. And this is going to be negative 7 equals 7 times 5 plus b. Negative 7 equals 35 plus b. So b is negative 42. So my equation is actually y equals 7x minus 42. And that is the tangent line. That's the exact equation of this red line we have graphed over here in Desmos at the top of the screen there. So that is the tangent line to the curve f of x equals 7 over 4 minus x at the point 5, negative 7. Okay, not only did we find the slope, but we found the actual equation of the tangent line. Okay, so there's our first example, first reason why we might need a limit. And the reason we need the limit there is because we can't find the equation of a tangent line to a curve with a single, we can't find the slope for that equation if all we have is a single point. We have to have two points to find a slope. So that's where our motivation comes from for the need to look at secant lines where we have two points, looking at those, making those secant lines get closer and closer to the actual tangent line. We did it here with a table, and we're making that get closer and closer to that actual tangent line till we can approximate, estimate the actual slope of the tangent line. And we have a very good estimation here.